Good evening, and thank all of you once again for coming to this memorable event. And we thank the sponsors for pulling us together. I also want to just thank again. It's unbelievable to me. We have alumni from the Eisenhower administration, but we have people who go back to the beginning days. And I just want to, they've stood once, but I just want to tell you who they are. Brad Patterson, Romer McPhee, Gene Rossides, Paul O'Day, and Steve Hess. What a remarkable group. And thank you for what you've done for our country. Coming here this evening, I was reminded again and again of a trip that I was blessed to take back in May with Secretary of Defense Bob Gates to Abilene. I'd never been there before, and I had a chance to view the Eisenhower home where he grew up. And it was incredible. It was a tiny little place, just I think about 1,250 square feet. And there in that house where when he grew up, there were two parents, often two grandparents, and six strapping boys, 1,250 feet. There was a reason why he spent a lot of time outdoors as he grew up. But equally memorable was the speech that Secretary Gates gave there, in which he went quite purposefully to recall the Eisenhower farewell and the meaning of the Eisenhower farewell and the warnings about the military-industrial complex. And he echoed that speech throughout as he pledged to find a new balance in America's armaments and a new balance in the way America conducts itself in the world. And to think that some 50 years later that the Secretary of Defense would make that special trip in order to invoke that speech, I think underscores how that farewell address, as Washington's farewell address did as well, how it echoes down through history and has continued to have an impact. And so tonight we're here to have a conversation with three people who have thought deeply about aspects of the themes that were sounded in that address. And what we'll do, and I'm going to ask each of them to talk for a few minutes, to give some introductory thoughts from their perspective. And we'll open up then and have a conversation among ourselves, and then we'll turn to you. There's a microphone here somewhere. I'm not sure where. It's right over here. But we'll be sure to give you time to prepare to ask some questions. And you can go anywhere you want. This is the Newseum. It's wide open. If you can have the practice of a high standard of journalism without all the viciousness of the blogs, we would welcome that. But let's go directly to Evan Thomas, who is now at work, I think on your seventh book, Evan, but it's a biography of Dwight Eisenhower. And Evan, of course, has written and thought deeply about these issues for a long time with Newsweek, but he's made a name for himself as a writer and as a thinker. So, Evan, I'm really looking forward to hearing what your perspectives. Give us some context for the speech, and then then you can bring us into the modern day.
Well, let me start with the modern day because that's what jumps out at me. I was reading Bob Woodward's book about Obama at war, and it just jumped out at me how overwhelmed President Obama was by his own military establishment. Now, he's a very good lawyer. He asked good questions, but he just seemed to be at the mercy of the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and General McChrystal, Mullen, and Petraeus. Not that they were venal men or even terribly manipulative men. They just seemed to have all the cards, and he didn't. I mean, as you may recall in that book, there's no... It's all about what we should do about Afghanistan. There's no discussion of getting out of Afghanistan. The discussion is, should we send 20,000 more troops or 40,000 more troops? The debate is absolutely laid out by the military. They decide to send 33,000 more troops. The issue is entirely framed by the military, and Obama seems helpless in this world. All I could think of was Dwight Eisenhower, who used to say about the military, "I know those boys." He'd been one of them. And I some random quotes here. This is a letter he wrote Sweet Hazlitt, his friend Sweet Hazlitt. "Someday there's going to be a man sitting in my present chair who has not been raised in the military services and who will have little understanding of where slashes, not been raised in the military service, and who have little understanding of where slashes in the estimates can be made with little or no damage. If that should happen, while we still have the state of tension that now exists in the world, I shudder to think of what could happen to this country. To General Goodpaster, he says, God help the nation when it has a president who doesn't know as much as I do about the military. Then to another speechwriter, you know, someday there's going to be somebody sitting in this office who can't look at that defense budget and separate the phony things from the valid things, and I feel sorry for him because he is going to be at the mercy of the military-industrial complex. When I took over, military spending, defense spending, during the Korean War had gone from about under $15 billion a year, $50 billion a year. Those sound like tiny numbers today, but that was a threefold increase in a couple of years. And Ike was just determined to bring it down. And military spending in those days was more than half of the budget. That's where the money was. And he did bring it down. But he did it under tremendous pressure to do the opposite. All of you familiar with, probably many of you familiar with NSC 68, this famous document written in 1950 that said we've got to be willing to spend to face the communist threat. They call for a $50 billion budget. Ike just resisted that. All these pressures all through his presidency, the missile gap, the bomber gap, Sputnik, Ike just had the sort of common sense to not panic. I was reading recently, he was reading an estimate that the Soviet army could sweep through Europe in 2 weeks, and he said, well, you know, actually it took me 3 months to get through Sicily. He did this, and this is the last point I want to make. He did this kind of in a low-key way. You may have noticed he wasn't the world's greatest speaker. He had a wonderful kind of confidence. He was so confident, really, of himself, about himself, that he had the confidence to not show off, to not need to prove how smart he was all the time. Famously, he went into a press conference once, and his press secretary was tugging in his sleeve and said, oh, they're going to ask you about this, and they're going to ask you about that. And Eisenhower said, oh, don't worry, I'll confuse them. He was willing to appear even stupid if necessary, if it served a longer aim. He always had his eye over the horizon, on the next thing. And he did it in this low-key way. He wasn't perfect. When he came in, we had about 1,000 nuclear weapons. When we left, we had about 20,000. You heard him say in the speech how disappointed he was on that front. He made mistakes. He was human, but he was pretty damn good.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Evan. Dana Priest has written some award-winning pieces for the Washington Post and has really, she's one of these people. I'm always reminded of I.F. Stone, you know, who dug so deeply into documents and background and really pulled it out. And some people disagree with him, but it was a real service to the country. And I'm curious your perspective now as you heard this speech today.
Well, I was in grade school when President Eisenhower died, and oddly enough, he's been with me ever since. First in college when I started to understand what he was talking about in this speech, but most recently in the last 20 years when I covered the national security beats for the Washington Post, the Pentagon, and then intelligence, and recently as an investigative reporter, which is what I wanted to talk to you about mostly tonight. After 9/11, at 9/11, I had covered the military, and I had just started covering the CIA and the intelligence community. And about 2 years into the war, when we stopped trying to figure out what al-Qaeda was, and we started trying to figure out what our government was doing about it, it's a time that's hard to remember back, but we didn't know anything. We didn't know about the secret prisons. We didn't know about what special forces were. We didn't know about strikes in the Pakistan region. We really didn't know much because the government was not willing to share it, and it was difficult to discover for reporters on the ground and then in Washington also. But those of us who've been doing it for a while said something's changing. We can feel it. There's something growing here. It's an amazing growth, as a matter of fact. And if you looked in the little clues that you could get, like the supplemental budget or the statements in the budget by Congress, 9 days after 9/11, Congress basically gave the intelligence community and the Defense Department a blank check. It came first in increments of a couple tens of billions of dollars. And that continued and continued and continued. And the defense budget, as we know, is more than doubled in size, and so has the intelligence budget. Unfortunately, the intelligence budget is largely classified. And that makes the whole idea that we can know what's going on with our government on this most important issue, how do you fight terrorism, it makes it nearly impossible to do, because you have to step into the realm of the classified world to do it. And that's difficult and sometimes risky for reporters. We know recently several of them have been alleged to have done things that the government doesn't like very well. So for the past 2 years, I've been trying with a colleague of mine, William Arkin, to try to just put a face on this world. We wanted to name it. We came up with Defense Intelligence Enterprise, but the but the acronym was DIE, so we said, no, we can't do that. Terrorism Intelligence Complex, I don't know. He named it the best. We can't quite best that. But what we found in 2 years, which is a series that I've just finished for the Washington Post, which can be found at topsecretamerica.com, which is what we ended up naming it, is that the number of organizations that have grown since 9/11 is in the thousands. That the number of companies that contract with the government to get the work done is in the thousands. Of course, Congress won't admit to this, but they made that possible. In fact, they made that necessary because when they were giving all this money to the government, they didn't want anybody to think that the government was actually growing to fight al-Qaeda. So they put a ceiling on the amount of money that the government could use, and they gave it all to the contracting world. They mandated that all these things had to happen, these things that they're now running away from. After 2 years of trying to map this world, and we actually did, we started by gathering the addresses of secret organizations and finding out where they were and going to look at where they were. We came up with what we call an alternative geography of the United States that you can see on the web. It's actually the geography of the businesses and government organizations that do top secret work in the United States. We started just saying, well, we want to see all the secret organizations and the secret contracts. At the secret level, there was just too much to keep track of, so we upped it to the top secret world. And we still got thousands and thousands of points on a map that you can go look at. And you see how the universe of the United States changes. The Capitol is actually not in Washington. It's near Washington around the National Security Agency, which is the agency that grew the most after 9/11, being very helpful in eavesdropping overseas on very quick targets, al-Qaeda, and little targets, not big armies. But our conclusions are conclusions that I think President Eisenhower would be rather distraught about, since he was warning us 50 years ago. And our conclusion, after interviewing hundreds of people inside the government or formally inside the government and also in companies that do work for the government, was that this enterprise had become so large, so unwieldy, and so secretive that nobody actually knows how much it costs, how many people are involved, or exactly how many different programs there are.
You think the government does not know?
No, the government does not know. The reason, I mean, I could go into detail about why that is, and I'd be glad to do that, but the person they put on top, the Director of National Intelligence, does not have oversight over everything. And part of the reason is because there are secrets upon secrets. There are layers and layers of secrecy that people within who should have visibility on all things were complaining to me about. And I'll just end with one quote, which comes from James Clapper, who is now the Director of National Intelligence. At the time that I interviewed him, he was the head of intelligence for the Defense Department, which has the vast majority of intelligence agencies within it. And he said, only God knows how many special access programs, those are the most highly classified, Only God knows how many special access programs there are.
Okay, that's great. Dana, thank you very much.
And finally, one other thing I learned from having listened to the speech again, I think there's an easy solution to all this, which is to take Eisenhower's own example and to require that all former presidents and executive leaders go to a farm afterwards and make the earth better than when they came. That might solve some of the problem.
Dana Priest. You've heard about Jim Fallows' remarkable life. Jim has been thinking a lot about defense issues for a great number of years, and one of the things I really appreciate about what he's always tried to understand where the world is going by going and actually living there. And so he went to the West to understand the new technology revolution, but then he and his wife and family went to live in China for 3 years. And someone who's really willing to, so few people, you know, so many people try to work at their desktop and understand the world. He goes and lives there and comes back, I think, with invaluable insights. So I've been looking forward, Jim, to hearing your reflections, given your experiences as you listen to this tonight.
Thank you very much, David. I have 3 points to make. The first two of them about this as the speech as a speech. I've spent much of my life thinking about speeches. I was once, I think David was too, I was a speechwriter for President Carter long ago. I've thought a lot about speeches, criticized some, admired others. So I'm going to talk about what we think about this as a speech. And then finally, as David's suggesting, I've spent a lot of my life thinking about the elements of American national strength and renewal in the long run and what we think 50 years later in the prescription that Dwight Eisenhower was laying out. The first thing to mention about this as a speech is the unusual reason that we remember it. Most speeches that are celebrated as great speeches are not so much known for the intellectual content of what they say. Because often if you boil down their message just to a topic sentence, it seems fairly banal. You know, we should be brave, Winston Churchill in World War II, or we should get along with each other, or things like that. There is a category of speeches that live on in people's memory because of the complexity and the seriousness of the argument they make. And I think this is one of that very small group. You can say that Winston Churchill's Westminster College address about the coming of the Iron Curtain in 1946 was one of those. George Marshall's Harvard commencement speech in 1947, laying out the Marshall Plan, was another. The original farewell address by George Washington, et cetera. There, you could go down and name some more, but this is one of them for the seriousness with which it goes into some genuine issues. And I've read this speech many, many times, but to hear it and hear the rattling off about all the balancing acts that are necessary for a nation to remain strong and for a statesman to balance the imperatives of the moment versus the long view, that is serious material. And so it is very impressive. That's why we remember this. You can contrast it, I think, also to John Kennedy's marvelous inaugural address, whose anniversary will be, I guess, the day after tomorrow, which was a wonderful performance, but again, it's the performance of it, like poetry, like music, as opposed to the thesis of it that we remember more, I believe. Second, as we look at the texture of this speech, I think it is remarkably carefully and in some places beautifully written because of in a way that didn't come across so much when Eisenhower was actually saying it because of the sort of plainness of his delivery. It's written not in statesmanlike language, but plain, specific language. There's one passage that I think is just remarkable. And if someone else than a former five-star general were delivering these words, you'd think they were seditious, left-wing, et cetera. Down the long lane of history yet to be written, America knows that this world of ours, ever growing smaller, must avoid becoming a community of dreadful fear and hate, and be instead a proud confederation of mutual trust and respect. Such a confederation must be one of equals. Again, imagine Barack Obama trying to say this. The weakest must come to the conference table with the same confidence as we do, protected as we are by our moral, economic, and military strength. Then this wonderful final sentence of this passage. That table, the conference table, though scarred by many past frustrations, cannot be abandoned for the certain agony of the battlefield. I think that's both vivid and profound, and it is very, it's why another reason why this speech lasts. Finally, my third point about the content part of Eisenhower's message that makes me wish a similarly serious treatment by a similarly influential and confident politician could be produced has to do with the part of the military-industrial complex that he did not mention during this speech. This speech was given, of course, in 1961, and he talked about the possible overreach from relying on the military for too many things. I look back and remember that in 1956, Dwight Eisenhower signed the National Defense Highway Act, or Highway System Act. In 1958, he signed the National Defense Education Act. In 1958, he also signed the creation of the Advanced Research Projects Agency. We look back on those as symbols of the infrastructure and the investment that America of mid-century in its golden age was giving to all of us. But again, even then, the justification for highways was National Defense Highways. For education was National Defense Education Act after Sputnik. For advanced, for what became DARPA, of course, it was Pentagon-funded research. The point I'm making here, and this is where I will close, is that through America's history, we have often relied as the military as a tool of national purpose. You know, the forts, the military forts were part of the settlement of the West. The contracts for early Colt armaments were part of what would build some of our machine industry. But even in Eisenhower's time, from that time onwards, it's basically been impossible to talk about national purpose, national investment, and national infrastructure without tying it to the military, without that having to be the vehicle through which we say we need this for the nation's good. I would like to have another Eisenhower of this era talk about how we can recalibrate that balance and talk about national purpose, the things we need in energy or health or whatever, without making it the National Defense Improvement Act.
So this is... we're now going to have a series of acts, National Defense Against China. And,
yes.
And there's going to be the preface to a number of acts we'll do on infrastructure.
Yes, exactly.
We have to do this because China's going to otherwise beat our brains out.
And on this point, one of my messages after living in China for these last few years is nobody should be that afraid of China. They have problems way worse than ours. Here's one anecdote I came across a day or two ago that I can't resist. If you wanted to imagine what it would be like for America to be strong in the way China is, first imagine every single person in the Western Hemisphere moving here. Every Mexican, every Brazilian, every Central American, have them come here. That would take us to 1 billion people. Then take all Nigerians and everybody in Japan and have them come here. Then we'd have as many people as China within our same borders. They got some problems. So, but we can use their example to spur us on in the comparison.
If you have not, I would commend to you because it will cheer you up. Jim's cover package in The Atlantic, it was some months ago. About American renewal and why he was more confident than many others are at the moment. But listen, running through this conversation is a sense that if Eisenhower were here today, he would be continuing to warn us because there are forces at work. I mean, Evan, you talked about the generals, you know, running amok in Afghanistan and sort of being controlling the president. And Danny, you talked about this secret America that is an intelligence military complex. And Jim, and fundamentally, you've got some warnings about where. What is being named and done in the name of national security, national defense? Are all of you really concerned about? I want to flesh out the argument of whether, in fact, we face dangers that are not the same, but are related to the ones that Eisenhower was warning about 50 years ago.
One thing that Ike was good about was just don't panic.
Right.
He had this ability to not get carried away with the moment.
And make haste slowly. I think that was one of his favorite.
Make haste slowly. He was endlessly patient. He had a hair trigger temper.
Yeah.
He could blow like a Bessemer furnace, but he was patient. It was kind of an interesting combination. And you compare that to the TV culture today, the talk TV culture, where everything is a crisis right away, every day, nothing but crisis. Ike would have just...
He wouldn't have made it in TV culture.
He sure wouldn't have. He would have been befuddled by it. He kind of liked TV, actually. He used to watch TV every night with Mamie. But he liked, you know, he watched the news and then go watch a Western.
He was the same great guy.
He knew how to lower his metabolism and the nation's with it.
That's interesting.
And get people to calm down. It wasn't easy because we had panic. Sputnik, you may recall how scared everybody was. He had a tough time holding the line, but he did on defense. They were ready to spend a ton of money in 1958, and he had to fight some pretty powerful people, LBJ, Stuart Symington, some Democrats.
But to come to today, do you think we face, are you seriously concerned about a military threat or a military dominance? And that's what Eisenhower clearly was worried about a shift of power to the military.
No, but I'm fascinated by General Petraeus, who is I think the world of, and yet I think he thinks the world of himself too. And you know, he's maybe a little too confident. And I wish there was an equal and opposing force.
Uh-huh. But there are many people who are thinking that the military has displaced the State Department, for example, and overseas relationships.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I think it was revealing that in Afghanistan and these rural reconstruction things, I forget what they're called. There are 40 of them. There's only one run by the State Department. The rest are done by the military. I mean, the military really have taken over. That's not all bad. A lot of these military guys are incredibly well-educated and impressive, but it makes me a little bit uncomfortable. And I got this feeling reading Woodward's book. I mean, you just, even if you admire Mullen and McChrystal and all that, they just have this just, it's just nothing but Joe Biden.
Maybe you can respond to this in terms of the intelligence thing, but there was with President Eisenhower in his farewell, this sense that there are these forces at work that have a momentum of their own, that are in effect that Washington is increasingly in the grips of an industry and a oversized military that are driving things, whether we like it or not, that are really shaping the policy of this country and the expenditures of the country.
I absolutely agree with that it's happened, that it's something to be very worried about, and it's not new in this administration or the Bush administration. It started during the Clinton administration. And I actually wrote a book on the whole subject in 2003 called The Mission, which talks about the expanding role of the military into non-military functions. And it happened because the State Department was atrophying. There weren't the sort of industrial-based support for it in Congress. The funding disparity, you know, Ike talks about a balance. We are so out of balance now that it'll be a revolution to try to get back into balance. That's just with money, but at the same time, the military, an incredibly professional organization, being able to get money from Congress, they not only expand their missions, but they educate their people. So they have professional schools that leaders go to. They get well-rounded. They learn how to take over the missions that they see the State Department not doing. And so being gung-ho people, they step into
the money they have enables them to train people, educate people, they get advanced degrees, and they have by far
and away. But on the contrary, the State Department is nowhere to be found. I mean, what the State Department doesn't know about the military is shocking. Yeah. And it's an alien culture to most of us because you've all heard the stats, but fewer and fewer people are serving, including people who are in Congress. So it's a culture and an institution that's becoming more distant.
And just to continue that, I think that three of the breaks that Dwight Eisenhower would have taken for granted on the shift in balance between the military and other powers just are not part of our situation now. One is, as Dana was just saying, was familiarity with the military culture. Now, in a way, we're more like the situation of, say, the 1920s or 1930s, where the military was its own little small world. But this is very different from the 1940s through early 1970s, when there was this mainstream immersion in military culture. So the confidence that Eisenhower said to say this part of the budget is crap and this part is necessary, fewer and fewer leaders have that anymore. So that's one of the breaks. A second is the funding break. You know, no matter what your partisan position now, clearly nobody takes federal government constraints seriously at all anymore. It's just there's money for anything. You can argue it's necessary for stimulus now, but there's no real break on funding for the military. And finally, there's the legitimacy question. That essentially is, again, as you wrote in your book, the military is the main way we can think of to do things either internationally or domestically. So that's all those things are not there as breaks anymore. Yeah, and he would have assumed them to be breaks.
That's interesting. Let me now come at you all from a different perspective and push back a little bit on one side, because you sort of presented the threatening side. But there are some who would look at the military budget of this country and say, wow, we're spending way too much. We're way over militarized. You know, we spend as much as the rest of the world combined, basically, on our military. And I think if you probably throw intelligence, it's more, essentially, for national security. But the other way of looking at it is look at the military spending as a percentage of our GDP. And as a percentage of our economy, when President Eisenhower left office, I think we were about 9%. Yeah. Military accounted for about 9%, half the federal spending.
Right.
And today it's about 4.5% of our GDP. In other words, as a share of our economy, it's actually shrunk.
Right. But
how do we think about that?
I imagine Eisenhower would be the first to say, just because you get richer doesn't mean you have to have more tanks, missiles, et cetera. If you need them, right,
yeah,
it means you can afford them
better. But if you think who's going to dominate your society, if you're worried about who's going to dominate, and they're a shrinking proportion of your budget or of your economy,
Hugh Shelton, who was the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, told me one time, and I've heard this from other military people as well, if all you have is a hammer, everything looks like a nail.
Mm-hmm.
That's the real problem. If your biggest and your most effective instrument is the military, you're going to solve problems through military solutions. So you're going to always favor that kind of policy. And even in Iraq, you have Petraeus, you have McChrystal, you have everyone will line up and say there's no military solution in Iraq and Afghanistan. And yet, that is 7/8 of our solution.
Yeah. In fairness, though, but let me push you on another aspect of this. Let's go back to President Eisenhower. One of his proudest claims was that he withdrew from Korea and he didn't use military forces after that, right? He kept the peace. But how did he keep the peace? He kept the peace through the CIA, and you've written about this, Evan. He kept the peace through the CIA. He kept the peace by using sort of paramilitary forces out of the intelligence community. You know, we went into Iran, we went into Guatemala, we did other things in order not to use the military force. So isn't there an argument on the other side
alternative. The alternative is a non-military.
But if you've got a nasty world out there, wouldn't you rather solve?
David, he didn't
really
do
interesting part,
the CIA played a role, and he had troubles controlling the CIA. That's true.
Right.
But that wasn't the biggest piece.
Right.
The biggest piece was that he threatened to nuke everybody.
Well, he did have that. He did have that. But let's look at what's going on in Iran right now. Would you rather use military force to deal with Iran, or would you rather have the U.S. intelligence working with the Israelis to put worms in their centrifuges and make sure they can't get
I'm for intelligence when it works, as in that case.
Right.
But as you know, the history of covert action is not success. It's lack of success. Right. I think Iran is a wonderful exception. It sounds like they're doing great, great things here. But in Eisenhower's era, and it began, they had some early successes in Iran and Guatemala that made the CIA think they could be kingmakers, but that was not true. They made a lot of mistakes.
Did he not substitute the CIA for the military in order to get things done? Now, you may say that's the wrong
solution. I think that's exaggerated.
I think
to some degree he did, but I don't think he was obsessively doing it. I don't think it was a huge part. He did a little bit of that, but the bigger issue was bluffing. He was a great card player. He was a great bridge player. In fact, he was such a good poker player when he was in the military, he had to stop playing poker because he was fleecing too many other officers. And he was a brilliant bluffer, and he really bluffed with nuclear weapons.
That goes well with the presidency, right? Goes well with the presidency.
The other thing that's so different from then is the internet and the power that it gives investigative journalists, other journalists, to know secrets. And this is an issue that we are most familiar with in the WikiLeaks example, but it's really hard these days to keep a secret. There's so much out there already. Our project that we put together was largely done using public sources. The government doesn't realize how much is out there. And with 24-hour news and reporters everywhere, it is hard to keep a secret these days. Mm. And so I don't think you could pull off something at your comment, it looks like the CIA might be doing a good job in Iran, is a good example of that. There's no, you know, there's been no actual confession, if you will, that they're doing anything in Iran, and yet we all seem to think that's true because our investigative reporters know how to dig a little better than they did back then.
It doesn't seem that they're making it quite as secret as they might either.
I think it's very hard to keep a secret. We know the whole contour of the global war on terror.
But the point is, aren't there uses of intelligence that where you may want to use intelligence rather than using your military. You may want to use the State Department. You may want to use all three.
And this would fit exactly with the leitmotif of Eisenhower's speech, which was balance in all things.
Yeah.
You need to have a sort of sophisticated, coordinated approach. And here we've mentioned a couple of times, all of us, how the disadvantage that our current president, Obama, has in dealing with the military. It's worth saying this. I think he is the closest temperamental match to Eisenhower that we've had in a long time. I was watching a video a couple days ago of some question he had from George Washington University students, and somebody asked him about dealing with the news. And Obama said, the hardest thing is that the news is always about what's happening an hour from now, what's happening tomorrow morning, and the most important things I do are for the little tiny steps that are going to matter 10 years from now or 20 years from now, which sounds to me something
read his piece today in the Wall Street Journal on regulatory state, it's all about balance. Mm-hmm. It's all about striking balance. Again and again he uses that. I was listening to the speech tonight. I was really struck. Wow, there's a real parallel. That's interesting. Let me ask one final question, and then we'll open this up. And I think the microphone's over here. This week we're commemorating not only, the President Eisenhower's farewell, but John F. Kennedy's hello and his inaugural address that occurred 3 days after the Eisenhower farewell. Bill Galston, who's sort of a resident political philosopher here in D.C., asked me an interesting question yesterday. If you looked at the Eisenhower farewell address and the Kennedy inaugural address, which was the wiser speech? Which was the wiser speech? Let me pose that to you all.
JFK's speech was a wonderful performance, and it did inspire many, many, many people. But its promise was we're going to bear every burden and pay any price. It was a prescription for getting us into Vietnam, as has been pointed out many times. We went too far out there. We thought we could save the world, and we couldn't. In that light, Eisenhower's speech does seem wiser because it's more cautionary. It's more, let's not get carried away here. They're very different speeches, and Jim has pointed this out. They're each great in their own way, but the one that got all the attention at the time, obviously, was JFK's.
Still does.
Because, I mean, you look at that photograph, JFK's young and tan and handsome, and Eisenhower's all bundled up in his coat on the stage. He looks like an old man who's ready to go. Yet he was the guy who really had said something that we substantively remember.
Dan?
Well, I'd have to agree, and partly it's just because he was so honest about something that he might not have a self-interest in, or he might have a self-interest in, and he was speaking about a culture that he knew, the military. So he had more credibility in a way because he came from that culture. He knew what they would try to get away from with.
And there's a reason why people were excited when John Kennedy came in, as I've been saying, of just this different new generation. And one of the big themes of his speech was the new generation that was coming to power. So in public life, we need the inspiration, even though it's not as wise in retrospect, and we need the wisdom. So I think that it is, to the extent that Eisenhower's speech has not gotten the acclaim relative to Kennedy's that it should, maybe we are part of a rehabilitated process, because I think, again, in its content, it's one that really stands. Something I meant to say earlier in the speech appreciation, there is a very, very small category of speeches which are remarkable both as performance and language and in their content. I think that's why Lincoln's second inaugural, and perhaps also his Gettysburg Address, are seen as above all other instances of American rhetoric.
Yeah, those are very insightful comments, and it does suggest to all of us today that we pay attention a lot in journalism to the flashy, to what's the performance, and we give a lot of attention. But in fact, some of the quieter speeches and quieter statements may actually deserve a lot more attention than we give them.
This is what the Atlantic Monthly is for.
Well done. Where's the microphone? Did you say it makes money, too? Where's the microphone? Is there a microphone here?
Yeah, it's right here.
Yeah, please. Please, this is the only microphone we have, so please come, and we'll get through it. Otherwise, I've got some more things I'd like to talk about. Please.
The presidential historian Michael Beschloss said on a PBS NewsHour long time ago, like October 2nd, 1997, that an earlier draft of Eisenhower's speech referred to the military, industrial, scientific complex, and that Eisenhower was, quote, very worried that the reaction to Sputnik had sent things in a very wrong direction. I wonder what you thought that what Michael Beschloss was thinking about. Was he thinking about Eisenhower's concern for the Sputnik event, which would fuel the Cold War? Or was he concerned about a line in Eisenhower's speech where he talked about the scientific technological elite?
To say one thing there, I had always understood the missing word to be the military-industrial congressional complex, but maybe that was in a different address. But I think one part of the speech which does sound strangest in retrospect is his fear about the scientific elite, which I think doesn't really resonate with how we think now.
Well, one thing that's puzzling about that, Eisenhower was very good at using scientists. He had his own science advisor. He was always smart about technology himself. He recognized the importance of the ICBM. So he was good at using science. He had more control over science than you think of most chief executives having. Maybe that made him, at the same time, knowing what science could do, maybe it made him wary. It is a time of extraordinary scientific advance, particularly in weaponry. I mean, in the course of his administration, they go from, you know, prop planes lumbering along towards the Soviet Union to missiles that can do it in, you know, 30 minutes and destroy the world. We go from the capacity to do a lot of damage to each other to ending the world in those 8 years. So he has a high respect for the power of science to deliver.
I think in that generation, too, it was there was this fear. I mean, Arthur Schlesinger Jr. used to write a lot about the real task of leadership is to stay ahead of technology.
Well, the arms race, I mean, any military guy like this knows the arms race favors offense, and it's a perpetually reinforcing, forward-spinning kind of scary thing to contemplate. And as I mentioned earlier, one of the failures of his administration was that the building of nuclear weapons got out of control. He was shocked in 1960. They put together our plan for bombing the Soviet Union into one plan called the Single Integrated Operating, Strategic Integrated Operating Plan, the SIOP. And Eisenhower was briefed on it and went, holy smokes, because we were making the rubble bounce all over the Soviet Union. He got out of control. He lost control of that element for a lot of complicated bureaucratic reasons. And he had reason to be fearful of the power of science and the military to do scary things.
That's interesting.
Thank you.
Please.
His farewell address, great speech. Realistically, could it have been much more effective if it had been his midterm speech? Why was it at the very end when he couldn't actually kick somebody's butt and say do something?
But it was actually a retrospective speech. He had been kicking butt all along. He was just doing it quietly and privately. He was not a headline hog. He was the exact opposite, actually. A lot of what he did to control the military, we never knew about.
Yeah. I think in fairness, too, there was a speech I think he gave with the American Society of Newspaper Editors earlier in the 50s,
in
which was very, very similar to what he then gave.
It's actually a bookend. The first speech he gave, I think it was called A Chance for Peace, after Stalin died in March 1953, he just got there, was on these themes. I mean, he was asking, look, every tank is three hospitals.
Right, it was a theft.
Every submarine is, you know, a bunch of schools. He was asking us to measure and weigh and balance these things.
Please.
Yes, good evening. I'm a graduate student at the University of Maryland studying American government. And I want to thank you all for coming and sharing your thoughts tonight. It's been very interesting. And I want to ask also, it's funny, the question I had has to do with the missing word. I had also thought it was congressional. And so I wanted to ask, first of all, why do you think the word was dropped in the end? And secondly, do you think if it were part, if we consider it overall, the military-industrial congressional complex, was Eisenhower just as prescient as regards today?
On the history of its being dropped, there probably are people in this room who can attest firsthand. There's a new book by James Ledbetter on the entire book is about this speech. And I think he goes into, I don't remember exactly the negotiations of dropping the word congressional, but you can assume it would be reaction from Congress, you know, the Republican congressman. But certainly looking at it analytically, it would have been sounder if he had included congressional there, because that actually is the Iron Triangle, as we now say, because it's appropriations through all the districts, and that's how the money keeps coming out.
And I think we have this a wonderful opportunity right now to watch this in action as Secretary Gates tries to cut the defense budget. Walter Pincus, who's here today, had this wonderful story in the Washington Post, I think it was yesterday, about efforts to do that and the rise against that in certain communities. This one happens to be a Marine project. So you're going to see that happening, and Congress plays a pivotal role in that. It's become a jobs program. Nobody even hides the fact. In fact, they talk in those terms now, saying these are jobs in my district. And how you then surmount that is going to be Gates' big legacy.
Andrew Bakovich calls it military Keynesianism. But coming back, Jim, to the congressional, there were some papers, I think, that were released by the Eisenhower Library here recently on other drafts. It was, I think, may have been the Malcolm Moose collection, but in which there was a section of the speech he was considering at one time, being very worried about it, whether it was the country was governable. He was having a lot of trouble with Congress.
Yeah.
Could you reflect on that a bit? Because that does seem to me also extremely relevant for today.
Yes, I will stipulate I have not pored over the recent releases as carefully as I should. And I read James Ledbetter's book in Galleys a couple of months ago. And so there is knowledge available on this topic that I do not personally possess at this moment. But I think that you see throughout this speech first-order seriousness on Eisenhower's part and the governability of the country, of whether it can maintain the sound balance and its position in the world and its finances and all the rest. And so I will stipulate there's a lot of discussion there about how the Congress fits in, and I urge everyone to go read these papers.
Well, I found a sentence in the speech tonight as we were listening. Our people expect their president and the Congress to find essential agreement on issues of great moment, the wise resolution of which will better shape the future of the nation. And, you know, that is sort of...
They no longer expect that.
They no longer expect it, and for a reason.
Right. they want it, but don't expect it.
Yeah, exactly. Please.
Yes, my name is David Martin, but I'm not that David Martin, the CBS guy. I have a website, dcdave.com. The conversation has been all about the military part of the military-industrial complex. It might be a good place to invoke this observation, but everybody knows now that a major military contractor owns one of the major networks. General Electric owns NBC, which maybe Eisenhower could say that explains why they were so uncritical of these wars we've been engaged in. But I wonder a little further, what would explain the lack of the critical attack of approach of the other networks and the other major news media as we engage in this burgeoning secrecy and burgeoning warfare that Ms. Priest talked about?
We could have a session many, many times this long about how the press and the public have responded to the challenges of the past 10 years and what sort of information was available when. I think all of us in our different ways have tried to raise the questions you're talking about in real time, you know, before the invasion of Iraq and the other. I think, however, the reasons, while complicated, are not fundamentally about corporate ownership. I think there's a lot of other reasons that I would place above that in when the press fails to report things, and also significantly the public fails to listen to them or pay attention to them. So I'd be happy to talk about this later on, but that's my opening gambit.
Evan, you wrote about this in Newsweek, and you went back and looked at what is it about us that did you felt and I felt that a lot of us got to too close to cheerleading going before Iraq.
Yeah, I mean, I think I just could see it in Newsweek in my own newsroom.
Yeah.
Before 9/11, we had been maybe too adversarial towards the government. After 9/11, almost with a sense of relief, we got away from trivial scandals and started writing about big issues. But in the course of that, there was, I felt, journalists have a fascination with war, particularly journalists who've never fought in one. And it's conflict. Journalists love conflict. Mm-hmm. And the greatest conflict is war. And I remember having this feeling around Newsweek that people were looking forward to the Iraq war, whatever the policy reasons for it were. They were just, there was almost atavistic thing going on, particularly after 9/11, that we wanted to show the world, teach them a lesson, if you were, by the show of force. Sounds very crude, but I felt it at the time. A lot of journalists who became big, harsh critics of the war forget that they were hawks at the time. You go down the masthead of major publications and run through the people who were pro-war, just a brief list, David Remnick of The New Yorker, Bill Keller of The New York Times, my old owner, Donald Graham of The Washington Post, go way down the list. To me, I was a hawk. So there was a very pro-war spirit in the press at the time for a lot of complicated reasons.
And I need to say that I was not a hawk. I thought this was not going to turn out well and did everything I could to argue against it then.
And you were right, and you were pressured, but you were in a minority.
Right.
Well, and I'd like to add that I don't think it's our role to be a hawk or a dove or anything like that, except if you're a columnist and you do get that latitude. As a reporter at the Washington Post and a team of reporters that were trying to cover the war or the before the war, the buildup, our job was really two things. One is to watch this machine crank up and to write about the stakes involved, the people involved, the thinking involved, what's the policy going to be, you know, what is the actual threat. That was incredibly hard to do. To try to find the threat and to try to find the doubts about that was not an easy task, again, because it was all classified, all of it. Anything that was not classified was a result of a congressional battle where we could get one line and then, you know, the other side would give us one more line. So it wasn't like there was a secret box somewhere where if only we knew where it was and had the key, we could open it up and aha, he doesn't have weapons of mass destruction. It just wasn't that easy. Many of us were frustrated at the Post because we thought we weren't getting our case heard in among honest other honest editors who don't have a corporate bone in their body, that's to address your question, but who thought that the buildup and all the activity around it often merited more. Yeah. And then to your point, there was plenty of warning, plenty of reporting that the aftermath would be chaos by experts saying this. And for some reason, that just did not resonate with people the same way this other coverage did.
Including with editors. I mean, there were people, you know, Jim, Walter Pincus, who's here, warned. I mean, there are definitely people in the press who are warning. But the overall coverage, the headlines, the thrust of the coverage was pretty uncritical.
I agree with that. I want to go to the other part of the question, though, then, that is whether the corporations that are getting the defense contractors and the intelligence contractors, I guess they're now called, I don't know what they're called, whether they have acquired a certain quiet, secret power that they can exercise through their members of Congress, through their districts, in which there's a momentum for weapon systems, there's a momentum for other kinds of black box things, for new technologies that just sort of go on and on that nobody really knows about, but they have a grip on the budget. And if you're really coming down to having to make hard choices about social programs, as we're going to be doing here, how do we open this up and how do we loosen the grip?
Well,
how serious is the grip and how do you loosen it?
I definitely think there's a serious grip. It's not because people are nefarious. It's probably not because they're looking to make a buck. It's because they're in this club that is a secret society. It's a classified world, and they depend on other people within that world. The first thing to do to open it up is to realize that most of the terrorist experts on television are not neutral. They make their money off of counter-terrorist technologies and policies, and they are rarely ever identified with how they really make their money. I mean, I'll give you one of my favorite examples is former Department of Homeland Security Chief Chertoff, who has the Chertoff Group, and who's raided many of the former DHS hierarchy. He took it with him. he's very professional. I don't have any doubt that he's trying to do the right thing, but he's on the television giving educated opinion, but he's never identified as, a consultant for various government agencies that do this business. So I think at the very minimum, people should disclose what their business ties are to what they're saying.
Yeah. So if you know anybody at CNN, you could have them start doing that.
Well, it's an issue that CNN has wrestled with. I mean, I, to their credit, they have really cracked down now because they felt, and I think rightly, as other news organizations have felt, we've got to clean this up. We've got to make sure that people are properly identified. But I do think that it's sometimes the associations are, you can have the Chertoff group up there underneath it, but it doesn't say anything. It doesn't really explain anything,
right.
Does it? You can identify who he works for, but... Right. And there's a hard problem for television is then how do you then, given the fact you've got such limited time, how do you really, if you go back and really work through what this person does, it takes you 3 minutes to get there. By the time the segment's over, it is a problem. And I think that the internet is a place where more could be done for disclosure and affiliations and that sort of thing that would be informative. That you could be thinking about, but I want to come back to this. It's not just a press question. It is it's really the question of these organizations. They have their spokesman out, but there are a lot of these organizations don't want to get in the press, and their contractors. We don't have any, and they're doing an awful lot of things in the field. I don't know how many people we have in Afghanistan and Iraq right now who are not military people; they're contractors.
Right. And you can't learn what they do because their contracts are classified. That's why Congress and its oversight is uniquely important. In no other realm do the oversight committees have as much responsibility for the very reason that all the contracts and the activities are classified. So they are not going to have an open hearing in which the various technologies will be debated or the various programs will be debated. It won't happen. So they themselves need to be better at what they're doing. They're way understaffed for that responsibility.
But Evan, the number of people in the field, say in Iraq and Afghanistan, there have been almost as many people who are contractors as military forces.
And that's a change, I think. I mean, at the CIA, they talk about the green badges and the blue badges. I forget, but the contractors outnumber in many areas in the CIA the full-time career staff there. In Afghanistan, I don't have the numbers, but I remember I went there and I was in McChrystal's command group when they canceled the contract. They were gleeful about it. The military guys don't love those contractors. They feel that they're out of their control, that they're much too macho, that they're breaking all sorts of rules, that they can't control them. They have no oversight. And I went out with one night to a restaurant called the Hot and Sizzlin'.
It was filled, hot and what?
The Hot and Sizzlin'. It was filled entirely with contractors and Chinese prostitutes. It was a scene out of a Star Wars bar. It was just the most amazing scene of just a restaurant bar filled with
in Afghanistan
with male contractors and their Chinese prostitutes. And there was a whole separate world out there that was outside of the military's control or the State Department's control. And I could feel the resentment and disquiet of the professionals.
Why don't we take these last two?
My name is George Wills, not the columnist, but I know him. And I'm asking a question. My work has been the combination of academic and business and consulting. And I spent part of my time in work as an assistant to Milton Eisenhower. The quiet, influential, but thoughtful person who advised the president. And I was thinking about, as the discussion went, it was a different era. And you all did an extraordinary job in talking about today, except for one area. Eisenhower had some people around him. His brother was an example who would look him in the eye and say, Ike or Mr. President, you're full of crap on this. You're wrong. Listen to me. And I think my concern is the nature of the presidency in terms of the individual's advisors. Do presidents have enough of that focus within their immediate coterie, their advisors, not just the cabinet and the public people, but people who will look them in the eye and say, you're making a mistake.
Yeah, Andrew Goodpaster played some of that role too, did he not?
With
Andrew Goodpaster played some of that role.
That's right. And the Eisenhower Library in Abilene is extraordinary just in terms of reading. And it's different. It was a different world. It was written. It was not the internet and unrecorded stuff. But at the same time, I think there's a question that still has to endure. Are there enough Milton Eisenhowers or Andy Goodpaster types of people in the circles of power to make an impact on the decision makers?
That's a very interesting question. Please.
I think the short answer would have to be there can never be enough of those people. But I think the comparison with Eisenhower's route to the presidency is a very instructive one with his successors. Dave and I have worked for presidents. You've worked for many presidents. I've worked for one. We've all interviewed or met them or been exposed to them. It seems to me almost impossible for a president in the modern era not to think finally deep down inside himself that if anybody else were as smart as he is, they would be president. You know, finally, he is the person who did this against all odds, went from being a peanut farmer in Georgia or a first-term a senator from Illinois and became the president and the most powerful person in the entire world. So I think it's very, very difficult and therefore all the more important a sign of wisdom if a president could surround himself with such people. The many, many decades of organizational leadership and responsibility that Dwight Eisenhower had had, I think, put him in a different position of sort of being wiser about himself. It could have given him the big head, but it seems, on the other hand, to have made him sort of wiser about his fallibilities. And I think that is a deep structural problem.
I was reminded there was one recent president, his name should go unnamed, unnoticed, but he used to close an argument sometimes. Take his finger, poke somebody in the chest, and say, if you're so damn smart, why aren't you president?
Right.
That would be the end of the argument.
And I think they all think that.
That's right.
Only a few of them say it.
Exactly.
Well, it's hard. I mean, it's hard to tell the president what to do. But Bob Strauss used to tell a story that people would come to see him on the way to the Oval Office, and they'd say, I'm going to go in there, and I'm going to tell the president a thing or two. And they get in the Oval Office, and they go, oh, Mr. President, you're doing such a wonderful job. And that's the norm. It's very hard to invite. The president has to actively invite dissent. Otherwise, people are going to be they're going to be deferential to him.
Yeah, well, Stephen Ambrose left behind a short book called Comrades. And there's a chapter in there about the relationship between Milton and Dwight Eisenhower. And that, I think, captured something about they were deep personal friends. They weren't just brothers, but there was a real kinship there that I think that allowed Milton Eisenhower to have that kind of freedom. I once asked David Herbert Donald, who wrote a magnificent biography of Lincoln, a historian at Harvard, no longer with us, what's the most important thing a president needs? And he said a friend. Interesting.
Yeah. Well, even though they're not friends, I think it says something about Obama that he's kept Bob Gates as long as he has.
I agree with that.
And has not at least has allowed him to go forward and push on this defense spending as he's doing
well,
now.
Well, how will Gates be remembered, by the way, given all that he's sort of in the Eisenhower mold? Would he be remembered?
I
would argue he's been one of our most successful defense secretaries.
I think that that's true to the extent that he's wise and he is a truth teller to some degree, more and more as time goes on.
I would agree that Bob Gates has been a great defense secretary, but reading the Woodward book, there's no wise man there. There's nobody saying to Obama, here's what you need to know. He's on his own.
That's interesting. Last question.
Hi, David Greenberg. I'm a historian at Rutgers. After two questioners rose about this fabled third word, I too had the privilege of reading Jim Ledbetter's book, Unwarranted Influences, which I commend to everyone here tonight. He explains this, as Jim Fallow suggested, there was no third word. This is kind of a myth that's evolved in the last, I don't know, 10 or 20 years, but Ledbetter went back through the documents. It's really... there's no written record of it. It came out of an oral history many years later. Somebody claimed this, but there's no real evidence for it. So I thought I would just, since Jim didn't get up to make this fact check himself as a historian. I felt obliged to.
Thank you for doing it. Thank you.
Yeah, that's good. What a wonderful way to end the evening. Well, I want to thank all three of these panelists. Thank Susie Eisenhower, everybody else. Thank all of you.